Okay. So, awesome. Thank you for being here after all this gala. I'm gonna torture you with SQL in this talk. So, the title of this talk, Beautiful Database-Centric Applications with Juke. That was the name of the talk when I started giving it, because I centered on Spring Boot and a technology called Juke. I've given this talk several times during this year, and in the time doing it, the topic changed something. Live with your SQL fetish. So I was googling for pictures to illustrate this talk, and I s stopped it. That was a good idea, wasn't not a good idea. So in the end, the talk will be about choosing the right talk, choosing the right tool for the job. So why me? My name is Michael Simons. I came from Aachen. This is in the western part of Germany, near the Dutch and Belgian borders. I have a local user group there in Aachen. I have a blog about Java, Spring, and software architecture. Currently, I'm working on a Spring Boot Buch in German. Probably not of that much interest to you, but maybe O'Reilly and Dipunkt will translate it into English. I've written a book about software architecture using a template ARC42, and down there is my Twitter handle. You find a lot of stuff, me rambling about family, biking, and software. I haven't written anything about my job. I'm currently in between positions. I'm starting at a consultancy in Germany next month, but up to now, I have created software in the energy market of Germany, as well as the financial part and the technical part. We have dealt with software where people go to the German energy exchange and buy electricity and gas. And we have an application where you can y see your usage of this data, the forecast of the energy usage, and the price they can realize with it. This data is stored usually in Oracle databases as time series. We don't use dedicated time series databases for that purpose. This is because this is kind of an old product with many developers who are strong in SQL, who are strong in data models, but not so much in more modern technologies, so to say. The other product where this stuff came to live is a desktop application, a geographical information system, where we plan and project the stuff you see in the image. These power rods in Germany are partially planned with our software. And this thing is also based on Oracle databases. There's an option inside the database, this is called spatial option. This is a set of stored PL/SQL procedures that are highly optimized for doing geographical queries, like give me all the stuff that are inside a bounding box or that are outside a bounding box, or you can compute whole areas with it. So the challenge there is to use the stuff you have paid for. You probably bought an Oracle machine or an Oracle license, and you have all these nice features. And if I just throw Java, Scala, or whatever against this database, I'm not using the features I've paid big money for. So that was the other topic I have dealt with. Java and databases, this has been a long history. I dare to say, you can do several things to communicate from a Java JVM program with a database. You can use plain SQL and stuff it into the JDBC driver. You can use an object relational mapping, ORM, or something in between. And there's actually a lot in between. I've listed a few. Already mentioned JDBC, Spring's JDBC template is an option. JPA, namely Hibernate or Eclipse Link, are options too. You can choose JPQL, which is kind of SQL, but type safe in the sense of object relational mapping. You can use a criteria query. You can use the tool I'm going to show you in the next slides, and many, many more. People always try to remember me. There's my Barties and other stuff. So the first question here is, why don't you just give me the right tool? And my answer to this is, there you go, the silver bullet. But honest answer, there will be no silver bullets, not in this talk. I have quoted my friend Jochen here, a good developer is like a werewolf afraid of silver bullets. If you go into a talk and you see somebody giving you a silver bullet here, take this, and you don't need anything more, then you should be skeptical, to say at least. So, to make this more concrete, I've brought an example with me, namely tracking musical habits, which is also kind of time series data, what I'm listening to and how much I listen to a certain artist or how much I like a certain genre or album. I have a very simple data model here. Let's see how this works. Yeah, I have a table called artists, a table called genre, a table called tracks, and a table how many times I played a certain track. Those of you who are familiar with database design maybe notice that this relational model isn't normalized very well. I've kept the albums inside the tracks, so I don't have normal form 2 here, it's just normal form 1. We can talk about this later if you want. This is a very simple model. If I want to have all the tracks of a certain album, I can just use plain SQL, select all the stuff from tracks where the album has a certain name. You see the table, you see a condition, the where clause, and you're fine with it. I don't want to write this in Java. This is error prone. It's not checked in compile time. It's not checked at runtime. It's not checked at boot time of an application. It's checked when a user clicks a button, and it's bad. You can use JPA. Everybody of you has ever seen a JPA entity? I think so. You can still see the name of a table, tracks. You can still see the select. At this point, the select isn't a SQL select anymore. This is a JPQL select. You see, I'm selecting from the entity. I have a condition, and oops, I'm filling in parameters over there. Yep, yada yada. This can be simplified if I use Spring Data. Everybody has heard of Spring Data. Spring Data is an abstraction above several data possible data stores, relational only one of them. Several NoSQL data stores are supported as well. At this code, I don't see my table anymore. I just see the entity we have. I don't write queries anymore. I can just declare a method, which is find all the tracks by album, and usage is, oops, and I also forgot the last one. Usage is very simple. I just call the method and be good. This is really easy. This is the code I like to see in a well-designed application if I just need stuff out of a repository, or just need stuff for a root aggregate in my vertical or whatever. But then stuff happens. Someone, usually business, demands a report or another feature, and feature could be, give me a chart like that. I have an input over there where I can select a year and a month, and that report should return the top 20 of stuff I've listened to in May 2016. You see the little arrows on the side, how much there's a change to the previous month. I've listened 3 more times than the previous month to that one, and here are no arrows where there is no change. The older people of you maybe remember this from MTV or something like this. It was called a chart. Yeah. So, I can select all the stuff you've seen on the previous slide with this query. So this is not Scala, this is not dirt on the white wall, it's just a very complex query, but it shows you stuff you can do with a modern relational database. I'm gonna walk you through this one. You see down there the source table, the tracks, right? Then I've there's a join on the artist table, and then there's a join and an outer join on the current month and the previous month. Those haven't been tables in the data model. Those are defined in the so-called with clause. This is something like an inline view. Some people use subselect for this purpose. Usually the optimizer can optimize this better, I think. And it's far more readable because I can declare upfront, I have this virtual table previous month and this virtual table current month, and you get used to it to read this like you do with the Scala code I've seen earlier. So, and what's inside those virtual tables or virtual views? Inside there is a window function. I compute, let me just use this one, the dense rank over the number of times a thing was played in a period of time. The dense rank gives me the incrementing number of the positions. So I have the top one, the top two, the top three, the top four, and the top, and so on. The rank would be, I probably could have three items at first spot, two items at the second spot, and so on. And back to the window function here. This is initialized at the over statement. A window function in SQL is something that moves through a set of records in your result set. I can have the window moving from the first record, step, 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 over every record. I can have a spanning window over several records. And this is actually what I'm doing here. I'm opening a window over the number of things played in this example. So I can group over this. Same here. Previous and current month to just compare the difference in number of times a track was played. So this is hardly readable. This is even worse readable if I take this query and push it into a JPR named native query. You should not be able to read this. This is just for educational purposes. What you see there is buttload of annotations, JPR annotations, and I don't want this. I've seen this in projects where people stuff queries into annotations, and I have several problems at once. I don't find these queries. They are not compile time checked. They are not checked at boot time of the application. They always break when somebody pushes a button, assuming there are no tests. And we spoke about it earlier. You should eat healthy. You don't should not smoke. You should write tests. And so you can see where this is going. This is the point where SQL meets Java. And this should actually be better readable. This is the same query written down in the domain-specific language that Juke offers for my project. We come to this later. This create variable is the entry point to the domain-specific language of Juke. And apart from that, it's Java code. And you see that the same constructs are used as in the SQL query I've shown earlier. So, can JPR Hibernate do this? Sure, but just because you can, you shouldn't. This quote is actually real. Gavin King is one of the inventors of Hibernate, and he himself just said, just because you're using Hibernate doesn't mean you have to use it for everything. And so, enter Juke. Juke stands for Java Object Oriented Querying, and labels itself as a query builder framework. It basically just does that at its core. It's used to construct SQL queries. It offers several possibilities to actually execute them and get stuff out of the database. This stuff can be records, can be objects, and as far as I know, it's currently worked on a better JPR integration as well, so that you can get out entities. Juke is basically a Java Diesel for generating database and schema specific statements. That means Juke aims to be a type-safe tool for your database. Type-safe in the sense that you can only use constructs your database offers, like the window function I've shown earlier, like the correct statements for counting stuff and so on, but also type-safe in the sense that it knows your data dictionary, that you can only select a table, that you can only run selects on tables they exist, and with the correct columns and with the correct columns data type. So schema's leading factor, and I have a corresponding Java scheme in my Juke application. Juke is an open source tool for open source databases and costs some money to a lot of money for enterprise databases, depending on how enterprise your database actually is. I find it's quite an interesting license model. There are a lot of databases supported. Everything on the right-hand side is free to use with Juke. This is H2, HSQLDB, MySQL, Postgres, SQLite. You get a free Juke license for that. And or going in this direction, you find all the enterprise databases, and the more enterprise it gets, the more expensive is Juke. Down at the bottom, there are Sybase, SQL Anywhere, Vertica. I've never heard of this, never used that one. We are using the professional version of Juke in the gray area because we bet on Oracle Enterprise Edition, which offers all the features we need. So how does this stuff work? Excuse me. Part of the Java-based schema is the build process. The build process applies the Juke code generator. This stuff needs to reinverse the database, so it needs some kind of development database. And I already have to have an SQL connection during my build process. This has some sort of implications for your team, for your work process, and I think there are several good implications coming to that later. So the build process reverse engineers your database and generates the mentioned Java-based schema. This sounds much more fancy than it is. It's basically a bunch of classes having some static attributes, reassembling your tables, your columns, your stored procedures, your foreign keys, everything that's in there. The application then uses the diesel context, which in turn grabs the Java-based schema and generates the SQL statements for me. Any questions so far? Feel free to interrupt me. Okay. So, as I said, it has some implications of your development process. Suddenly, database migrations are essential. Having a consistent state of your database in terms of schema is essential. And you all work in consultancy, and I think you have seen databases that are not so consistent with the development database you have in your project. So there can be surprises if you rely on generated code. Everybody knows what a database migration is. It's changing the schema in a controlled manner from one version to another. And I always recommend two tools there, which are Liquibase and Flyway. Both of them are pretty well supported in Spring, and especially in Spring Boot applications. Right? In my demo and also in production, we use Flyway because it had, for our use case, better support of native scripts than Liquibase. Liquibase knows SQL dialects as well, but I found the support in Flyway better, but it's just a personal opinion. The workflow we are recommending in a Juke-based application is as follows. Every developer should have a development database. I think it's ridiculously easy today. We have seen Kafka and Docker. We have get Docker files for all kinds of databases, including Oracle from the official repo. And the developer starts, it's built against the local development database, and the build starts the migration using a tool like Liquibase or Flyway, and then starts the Joux code generator. And the application then runs at some point, hopefully, against the production database, starts the migration again, and doing this ensures that the database scheme is always in sync with the Joux scheme. This is a point where you have probably to deal with your customer's database administrator and answering questions why your application is allowed to modify a scheme, not him. Those are social problems that has to be solved, organizational problems that has to be solved, but I think it's good to speak about these problems in production. And you can clarify which application has the right to modify and to dictate the schema of a database. It's pretty relevant in terms of microservices, and you can very fast spot situations where some applications are integrating over databases. I've heard that can happen at times, right? Okay, and then all the interesting thing, how to use this with Spring Boot. Everybody knows this site, start.spring.io. That's good. You can just use the dependencies over there, get Joux and Flyway, and you're good. Then you get those Spring Boot starter Joux and the dependency to Flyway, and you're good to go. If you have a commercial database, there's something more to do. You have to exclude the open source version of Joux and include the professional version. You should reuse the managed version of Spring Boot there, but that's all you have to do if you want to switch to commercial version over there. The build process is a little bit harder. I personally are a Maven fan for whatever reason. I have Maven in this example, and I use a properties block in Maven to define my database connections. You see the database URL, you see database username, password, schema, and inside those properties go the credentials and connections for the development database. This is not production database. In Spring Boot, you can basically configure everything about from properties. Properties can come from the environment, from application properties, from application YAML files, from a config server. In the build process, I use application properties and facility to refer to Maven properties with the at sign over here. This is built in Spring Boot. If you use the Spring Boot Maven plugin, those properties get filtered. So I have the properties from Maven automatically in my development target. The reason I'm doing this is because I need the database connection further on in the build process. So I wouldn't do this if I would not need them in the build process. Okay. So nobody said he doesn't know Flyway or Liquibase. Flyway is supported in different context. It can be run in the build context, and it can be run from a Spring Boot applications. In the build process, we obviously are not in the Spring Boot context, so I configure the build time migration with Flyway as well, and this is the point where I need the same database connection, right? As a location for the database migrations, this is all the SQL files I want to apply to the database. I use the same location that Spring Boot does per default. This is source main resources DB migration. I've heard that I can omit this in newer version of Spring Boot and Flyway integration. Anyway. So the Joux code generator always after migrations, obviously, because the generator looks at the schema, and if I do it vice versa, it would look at the wrong schema. There I can refer to the same Juke version, but use the Juke CodeGen Maven plugin. Again, here are the properties I had to define in my build script. And the generator has a lot of settings that says whatever that I don't configure here. The generator can be configured which types of objects it should generate. It can be configured which to exclude by name or whatever. You can configure type mappings, a lot of stuff. But that would not fit into this talk. So before I come to a demo, any questions so far? But okay, it's a good question. Most migration tools have a meta table where they store their currently applied version, and you can actually use this in your Juke code. So Juke logs into the database, reads the table, sees, okay, I haven't run this, I haven't seen this migration, so I have to regenerate or don't. So that speeds up your development process a lot. Yeah, same category is how fast is it if you have a database with like 50,000 table objects into it? It's kind of slow. Slower than usual, right? Okay. So demo time. I hope this works. The first thing I'm this off. The first thing I'm going to show you is how the final applications will look like in the end. And you see that it's too small. Sorry, that is a normal Spring Boot application over here, which I can fire it up using MVN Spring Boot colon run. First thing we see is the migration during build process here. I started against an empty schema, and then 9 migrations have been applied during build process. And after that, the promised code generator runs and generates a lot of Java classes. You see here the database parameter, the connection or whatever, more configuration settings, a banner, everybody has banners these days. And then code generation is done, yada yada, and finally the Spring application starts the next banner we see, right? Let's see if I find the point. Hibernate starting up, if Hibernate inside this. I'm looking for the flyway messages about migration, yeah, over there. There it is. This is the flyway migration during runtime. It just noticed this database has been migrated. It doesn't need more migration. That was would have been the step if I run this into production. Okay. So and the application looks like this. You don't see anything over here. This is not interesting. So this would have been the stuff I've been listening to in March 2016. A lot of German band called Die Toten Hosen. Those charts are generated from one single SQL statement, which is actually the stuff I've shown you earlier, which gets locked if you configure Juke in a nicely formatted manner. Here again we see the with clause, the window functions, the selecting of the columns, the sources of my stuff, the joins, etc. What's really nice for development purposes, I get those statements with the placeholders. You see here the question mark, and the second time without the placeholders. Where is one? Okay, it's only the limit clause here at the moment. But if you're doing this database stuff, you can just copy paste them, send them to the database administrator or database developer for manually optimizing them or whatever. You get a very nice log, and I think it's really readable and really valuable for development purposes. The last thing I show with the complete demo is that migrations can also be applied during runtime if I'm using Spring Boot development tools. I'm just dropping some more scripts over here, and application restarts and migrates. Three more scripts, and if I reload this page, you see data from 2017. I've been listening to Falco a lot, obviously, and Queen. Yeah. Before we go into coding, I'm not gonna show you the monster selector. Probably I will show you the monster selector if you want. We can discuss this later. What we gonna code in the demo is stuff that provides all artists that are inside the database, Pink Floyd, and dynamic, an API for selecting this stuff. I know there's screen data somewhere, and a method that that uses SQL to create data for a report like this. This report is the cumulative plays for Queen over a time. A cumulative play is until February. I've listened 21 times to Queen. Then during March, I've listened 19 times more to a cumulative play of 40, and so on. I hope everybody gets the point of this demonstration. So, into my IDE. This is not the complete application. This is now a fragment we're gonna fill. We're looking at the Maven build file, the POM, where you find all the stuff I promised earlier, namely the connection to the databases, the dependencies over here, Spring Boot, Starter, Juke, and the Flyway Maven plugin for build time migrations, and the Juke code generator for running after build time migrations. Nothing fancy there, okay? Application properties, as shown on the slides, are replaced during build time with the actual values. And now to some Java code finally. This one is the controller that has been used to fill the dropdown with the artist I've listening to. And this one is the entry point, the diesel context in line 32 to Juke. This stuff gets auto-injected from Spring context automatically by just providing the starter. I'm going to show you later how to configure more of that, but it takes place in the Spring application context like everything else. And I've omitted all these add injects or add auto-wired, so I can basically keep my code mostly free of annotations of any kind. Okay. Before anybody hits me, I'm just pushing business logic into the controller, and this is not a REST API, it's just some HTTP API, and I would not recommend doing this stuff in production. Okay. Hmm? We all do this, but... So, if you want to write a SQL select statement with Juke, you just write it like you would do it in SQL. Run the. Why? I think I need my sheet. From artists. Artist is one of the generated classes from my Java schema, which have been imported. You can order it by any column. Artist. And at this point, Juke didn't execute queries so far. These queries will be executed only if I call the fetch method. I always fell for this one, especially on updates. I write my updates down and always wonder why the test fails, because I forget to execute or fetch. And then I'm using a convenience method here to create the HTTP AP by just writing to the output stream. Okay. I have to start this instance of the application, and in the meantime I can grab my cheats. Okay. This is the second instance, and the first start is a little bit slower because I have to recompile everything. Any questions so far? Yeah, but what do you mean?
ID support. If, for example, I already have my database, I have my library scripts.
Yes.
If I start changing an existing call, I drop something or whatever I'm doing, then I need to run it or I will get compiler errors.
Yes, you have to rerun the migrations, this is true. You can run the corresponding Maven goal with it. That's the way I run it. You can first run the Flyway Migrate goal, and then you can run the corresponding Juke goals. That's the way I would do it. Okay. So while this starts up, just gonna show you the generated classes. Those generated classes, they are important for having type safety across SQL constructs and across the stuff I'm using, but they are not fancy at all. You see, it's just a bunch of static members, and they represent the tables I had in the slides. The artist table has an ID and a name. Artist, I should probably have called this field name anyway. So back to the code we have written. Let's see if this works. Getting all the artists from the controller looks like this. And funny. It should give me. Interesting. This is interesting because I didn't expect. I expected JSON code. It had JSON code the last time I run it. Funny. Okay, it's interesting. I didn't know this is possible. You see here a result set pretty much like you get from MySQL running the stuff, because I actually wanted to use this method, but okay. So I should get some JSON out of it. So this is the JSON code that Juke generates me, and that is used in the front end I've shown you earlier. Okay. But if we looking at this method, I'm not saying that is a use case for Juke. That is getting started with Juke. For that stuff, I would use Hibernate, JPR, or whatever is there and fits my company or my team. The API that gets me the cumulative place looks much more interesting. Gonna copy some stuff over here. The query I'm gonna write is that one. I'm gonna try rewriting this query by hand using Juke code and explain what it's doing there. This is I want to have a date field truncated to a day, and I can store elements that I use in a SQL query on variables, so that I don't have to repeat them. This is actually also faster, because Juke tries to reference variables as well in the queries. So plate on truncated to day, and then I have some static imports here, so otherwise I wouldn't be able to use a trunk method here. I reference the table place, the plate on field, and I only want to have the date part, and I have to cast this for whatever reason. So this is the field I'm gonna roll over the window to get my cumulative place, and then I just start writing my SQL as I want to. I'm gonna select the date. I truncate it. Artist, this one. I select the artist I wanted to have the place, and now I'm gonna start rewriting the window function in line 58 with juke code. It's pretty easy. I can write it just down. Still one. And now opening the window over order by plate on and give it name as cumulative place. So, and I have a fine select. I would have a really, really hard time pushing that into Hibernate or using JPQL. It would not be possible. And after that, we have to tell the thing where to get this. I need the table place. This is my driving table. I'm going to join the tracks. And yeah, we have seen all kinds of databases with or without foreign keys, and it's good idea to use foreign keys to model your schema the correct way, because you then can join tracks on. You can do stuff like this. You can join stuff on their keys. Tools can read this stuff and work with it. I'm gonna join the artists into it as well on key. Throw in a where clause, artist ID equal artist ID. This variable comes from the definition of my request handling method here in Spring. I have to do a group by as well. Missing a closing one. This one. Group by plate on truncated today. Artist. Order by same stuff. You see, I'm always reusing the field I have computed in a trivial way, but I'm still reusing it, and Juke recognized that I'm reusing it. Should be better on performance. Again, I have to fetch this. And now, JSON response get output stream. So let's see if this does not order by. There's probably an import missing. Okay. So this method basically gives me the data I need for this graph over here. And when I call it, I'm using here artist number 86. It's Motorhead. I like Motorhead. I have again Juke's idea of good JSON code. So far, everything I've done is pretty much record oriented. Okay, I don't have any objects so far, and this shows in the JSON generated. That would be that query. Just for completeness, I'm gonna show you the chart report controller. This monster query looks still horrible as Java Juke code, I give you that, but at least I have compile time 70. I have checks during runtime. You can read all this code in the, I have a GitHub repository for this talk. It's all there. I give you the links at the end of the talk. Okay. Before anybody asks me what about objects, what about domain-driven design or whatsoever, I think selecting stuff this way gives you a good start for modeling your domain. This chart example is obviously record-oriented. I have this typical use case where business drops in and says, I need this report by tomorrow and I have to get this report. So I'm not modeling stuff right there, but if I do, often SQL is a good approach to modeling your aggregates. You can fill the stuff you need, you can select the stuff you need, and you don't fall for the trap, oh, you've written add entity at your domain class and hey, fine, I'm doing domain-driven design. You actually can concentrate on what's important over there. So this controller, okay, it's readable, hopefully, looks more like a Spring Boot REST controller. You know, I've also written REST controller at the top of it. And this one returns actually stuff and doesn't write to the output stream of the HTTP request. And it uses, at this point, a generated class named genres, which I can fill with a simple Juke query. This create select from genres. Can order this again, order by genres. Genre. And the interesting part is now that the fetch method looks different, fetch into, and I give it a class. Genres. Adding the return statement. And I should be able to get myself all the genres in no time. So this looks more like the stuff you're getting from a Spring REST controller, right? The reason why this genre class is in plural is not because I opted, I chose the name genres in plural. I would call it genre in singular because it's that genre, not many genres. This is a generated class from Juke, right? You can use Juke to generate POJOs. The name is debatable at this point, at least for me. I'm have an eye for this stuff. Juke is pretty good in mapping stuff automatically. It sees the table has an ID, it has a column name and a column genre, and it maps it automatically to those attributes here. If I go into more modeling stuff, like a genre with play count, give me all the genres I played the most, and I have this value object here. I also can use this built-in Juke mapping. Looks a little bit different. I have a field. This time I call it count field. Should be the count above all genres. And this time I select the name of the genre, that field. Again, from my driving table place. As well. I can join the tracks on key. Join them on key as well. Group by genre. And interesting stuff is always the order. Order by. And fetch it. Okay. So I get now all the genres with their play counts. Internal server error, that's nice. Missing return statement, yes, yeah, true. And just edit. Okay, this is the wrong order. I want to order by the count, obviously. It's much more interesting. Yeah. You see, I'm a big heavy metal fan. Okay, I've listened a lot to heavy metal over the last years. So the last thing I'm going to show you into this demo is the Juke config. Okay, just one more thing about this mapping stuff. Juke is smart enough to map display count here. It decides by having the name, the string field and the integer field, but this can be customized the hell out of it. You can use several mapping tools, map struct or whatever else you have in place to do a mapping between your record types and your domain objects, anything you want. Juke is a first class participant of Spring Boot's auto configuration. If I just introduce beans of the fitting type into the context, like the record mapper provider to customize the mappings, or this class here over there in line 22 settings is a Juke class where I can configure the rendering styles, whether it should be formatted or not, can all be done in a Spring Boot way. I just declare it and be fine. Part of this also can be configured from the environment. So that's for this demo. What we've seen so far is have really easy options to map queries to URLs. Queries can be very simple, but can be also very complex. I have a cool, good logging for queries if I need it. Okay, I skipped the part where I've shown that Spring MVC parameters can be used without having to fear SQL injection. That stuff is type safe. I can reuse query fragments. We have seen this. We have seen how to use POJOs and other types. We have used records, and I can also use a data access object approach, either by generated data access objects or wrapping this stuff in repositories. And one can use Juke as a SQL generator only. Questions so far? Yeah, sure. Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. That depends on how the named queries are processed by your JPA provider. If it actually uses prepared statements, then it should be faster because those prepared statements resides in the database SDO memory or not. Okay. This is true, absolutely true. You can achieve the same with Juke. You can use the generated SQL and pass it as a prepared statement. But there you have to do this yourself. You're in control. I've seen cases where JPQL queries have been used as real prepared database queries, and sometimes they don't. So it's like the one-to-many, many-to-one bidirectional relationship. You always surprise people if you make one lazy or not. And, you can do this with Juke, and you're in control what you do with it, right? Okay, the other point that has been asked at this demo is whether this is portable or not. The demo now runs on a PostgreSQL database. On the slides, you have seen something from DORC and Oracle connection parameters. When I first created this demo, I used an Oracle database because I've also shown it to customers and at an Oracle convention. This thing is, okay, there is it. This is pretty much portable. Juke knows database specific statements like the, I had the limit and offset inside. Limit is a standard SQL. Oracle uses offset. The trunc methods for truncating dates or stuff differ slightly. Also, extracting dates differs slightly, but it tries to translate, and it works pretty well. I could change this talk to Postgres in like an hour or so, but honestly, if you run those queries, it's not your primary goal to be portable across like 10 databases. Usually you do this with a specific idea in mind. Yeah. Then the question, when to use this? This quote, it's not maybe fully real. The SQL, it's always been there. it will guide you. It's been set by Lucas Skyader. It's a SQL Jedi from Swiss. But take this with a grain of salt. Quotes on the internet maybe not always accurate. I would use this stuff if I have to use analytic functions. If I have to use database specific, if I really have to call stored procedures, built-in stored procedures, if I have to use huge merge statements, so-called upserts or something like this, if it's important for me to do only partial selects in the sense of I only need like 5 columns of a table which has 35 columns. If you have a wide table with many rows, it has an impact of your JPA performance. If you select just the entities and you use only one column of it, it's pointless to put all the pressure into memory. Yeah, calling stored procedures is another thing you can do with this stuff. So, back to silver bullets, right? And fetish-oriented programming, I said, I stopped Googling for pictures. it's better. But it's also a good idea not to do fetish-oriented programming. I found one interesting article about fetishes. Fetishes can be EDEs. It can be tabs or spaces. It can be semicolon or not. You can waste your time fighting about fetishes, or you can just don't. So nothing is more dangerous than an idea when it's the only one we have. This has been said by a guy who lived between World War I and World War II in France, and I think this is pretty true. You have to know the tools you can use, or your tool belt, or whatever, to be prepared for stuff that happens at customers, at projects, or whatever. So this is the reason why I have the last slides here. I think I'm a bit over time, but I would like to show this stuff because this is really good, using JPR and Hibernate as far as it brings you. And if it doesn't work out for you, just use Juke or another SQL tool there. You should do automatic database migrations. And this is one thing I would fight for after 5 years not doing this. Then use JPR with Spring Data JPR. Spring Data is an awesome project and it brings JPR and Hibernate to a whole new level. Use JPQL queries if necessary. They work fine, they are runtime checked. If you're really into pain, go to Criteria RP, have fun with it, but don't blame me. What you please don't do is hiding native queries and annotations. They will come back for you. Create complex queries in projections with Juke and pass those queries to the entity manager or just run them directly. Okay. So for the last demo, I came up with a classic SQL interview question. Those stuff happens if you apply for DBR stuff. Give me the thing or genre that has been played the most. Right? There are several solutions to this question. What could be a one solution, anyone, without SQL code? Count by the group by, but then I can end up with like 5 at the top one, right? But who is decide what gets drove off, right? So also as an added bonus, as a JPR entity, so this is just mean, right? My solution would be this one. Select the stuff I need for an entity. And then again, use the window function, at this time the rank. This is not the dense rank, so I can have like 3 items on the first spot and 5 items on the second spot. The rank over the count star, yeah, Bart set it, and then select all of them at first place so I don't have to drop stuff with the distinct clause. Okay, would be one solution. How to use this with Spring Data? This is now a little bit advanced Spring Data stuff. I can declare interfaces with Spring Data. that just return a list of entities and give it a name, find with highest play count. This my custom interface, so far nothing to do with Spring Data. Then I introduce a class implementing this interface. I make use of an auto-wired entity manager, so this is JPR tutorial ground now, and again the Juke diesel context, and I have to implement this method. So I now use the Juke instance as a SQL generator, and this is why that's the reason I gave it this name. I can extract the SQL code, pass the SQL code to an entity manager, and just return the list of entities. And then finally, Spring Data, I have wrong direction. I have how does this thing work? I have this interface genre repository that extends the CRUD repository from Spring Data and my custom repository. And this is a little bit abstract, so second demo is okay if I show you the stuff. It's faster than the other one, I promise. So I've prepared everything mostly. Genre repository over here. I've just stuffed everything into one file, it's easier. This is the custom interface I've introduced with one method. I want all those entities that have been genres that have been played the most. This stuff has to implement genre repository ext. Now start complaining, please. Implement all methods. I need an entity manager. And then need the diesel context. Can give it any name you want. That's the nice thing about Spring Boot and JPR. I have an injectable entity manager. I don't have to fiddle with the persistence context. I really like this. This is good stuff. So I hope I'm fast enough. Highest count SQL. This is the query I've had on the slides. I'm not gonna write this down in Juke again. You can highest count Juke. This is the SQL generator with the same query. It's the same principle I've shown earlier. So now the interesting stuff: how to get the SQL 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 generator get SQL param type. I can extract all the SQL code that this thing generates me as one string and with named parameters. So the name obviously corresponds now to database column names, not to entity names. And I can then use query is at this point a native query instance that the entity manager gives me. Entity manager. Create native query SQL genre entity class. So last thing I have to do is to fill the parameters. I get those from the Juke instance as well. Get more params and can use a lambda name param. And fill set parameter name param get value and this one, and then I can just use the methods we all know from all those native queries we've hidden away in some entities. Okay. So that should already compile. We have been to the genre controller before. I use my newly created repository here. Drop that instance variable. get myself this stuff. I'm not a big fan of attribute injections. I'm always using constructor injections. It helps to keep your stuff coherent and concise, I think. So that should... I can use all the repository and just remove them. So I can use the repository now. Find with highest play count. And this is more the stuff you should implement in production. And I cannot tell what's inside this genre repository. It gets me entities like everybody knows, and the method doesn't give a hint that I'm using actually a complex query here. And saving this should restart the application. This is the wrong with highest play count. Okay. And yeah, you have been there before. I've listened to a lot of heavy metal. Okay. So I don't understand where my repository went. There it is. This is the way. If I have to go to native query style, I would use something like Juke to make this obviously what I'm doing here, and to make this type safe, and just to have a nice clean API. Yeah, that would have been this demo. Well, I'm not yet finished. We skipped the part where I speak about testing. There has been testing support in Spring Boot for Juke classes. You can mock stuff with Juke, but actually I think Juke is a candidate for only doing real integration testing. That doesn't make much sense to mock your database, because if you mock your database, then what's the reason for having a database at all? So you should run integration tests with this stuff. Yeah. So, questions so far? Yeah. I should really take some time to have a look at QueryDiesel. I have never ever used QueryDiesel, so cannot answer this question, sorry. So if there are no more questions, I thank you for your time. I have all the code, the slides at GitHub and SpeakerDeck. You find me on my website, on Twitter, and most of the, at least Dutch people I know, are pretty fluent in German. I have the Spring Boot book coming out. I hope maybe it's something for Belgium as well. There's an example for persistence, which includes more Juke code and a comparison between JPR and other stuff as well. So thank you very much for having me here.